Hello and a very good afternoon to everyone. We welcome you all to the third day of the Supply Chain Triathlon, a series of power-packed knowledge sessions on LinkedIn Live, organized by Logistics Insider and powered by Gina and Company. The COVID-19 pandemic has changed our lives in ways that we never imagined. One thing, however, has become very clear, and that is the continued importance of global trade and commerce and of initiatives supporting the smooth flow of goods across borders, especially essential goods to areas where they are most needed. We take great pleasure to announce that today's session marks the first event by Gina and Company under their innovative umbrella concept of embracing the new normal. Gina, a century-old company, time and again, has been recognized by the Indian Customs as impeccable in terms of compliance. Customs had also approached Gina and Company for their assistance when the GST implementation was done. With innovation at its core, Gina believes in continuous process improvement, which will ensure a seamless experience that is provided to all stakeholders. Customs forms the backbone of any country's foreign trade policy. As a cardinal organ of the nation's EXIM policy, the customs process facilitates seamless exports and imports while also exercising caution and care in safeguarding the nation's security. In today's session, we touch upon the role of customs as an enabler in trade and business, the road to having a hassle-free customs clearance experience, and much more as we take valuable insights from the industry leaders. Today's session will feature Dr. Pramod Sand, Head of EXIM and Customs, Siemens, Mr. Saurav Kumar, CEO, of GMR Hyderabad Air Cargo and Logistics, Mr. A.V. Vijaya Kumar, Chairman, Federation of Freight Forwarders Association of India. And it will be moderated by Mr. Hardik Thosani, Senior Manager, EXIM, from Gina and Company. So without any further ado, I would request Mr. Hardik to take over from here. Over to you, Mr. Hardik.
Thank you, Vasundhara. First of all, I welcome the speakers and a very good afternoon to everyone. As we see, you know, the customs has been an important organ of our nation's trade. So I think we can start directly in terms of the discussion. And first, we can take the subject as, you know, how the customs has been instrumental in enabling the EXIM trade. So I would like a direct answer right from the trade representative, that is Mr. Pramod Sand, to please enlighten us with, you know, how the customs has been instrumental in enabling the EXIM trade and what are the value additions which have been done by the customs in the country's economy.
Thank you, Hardik. First of all, thank you, Logistic Insider and Gina, for organizing such discussion. I am quite sure that such type of awareness and the discussion will help industry and various stakeholders to take the things to the next level. So thank you for this. Regarding Hardik, your question, what is the customs role into the trade and enabling into this thing? So I can first mention that we need to look at from where the customs started and where it has reached now. If you look at the customs earlier image, which was very different, that earlier custom is looking for revenue collection, it was having laborious processes, lot of documentation, manual processes, physical inspection, which used to be 100%, and no timelines or commitments, which was the starting point. But from that point now, the custom has changed its, you call it evolution in custom paradigm. that today custom do not talk about the revenue collection. Their first motive is citizen safety and welfare. Then they talk about national security. And then the third thing comes as a revenue collection. But at the same time, there are a lot of initiatives like automation, digitization, risk-based intervention. So people, and there is a trust culture. They say that in industry, if you are a good industry, you are trustworthy, we will give you benefit. If you are not trustworthy, then you will face the normal processes. You will not be facilitated. Then there is a predictability and certainty. Today, what we want is very important, that can my consignment get cleared from airport or seaport in how many days? And how fast I can do the export? So, another thing.
Sorry, sir. Just to make it more concentrated, I think, sir, customs have introduced more facilities per se. So we would like you to highlight on the facilities which have been provided by the customs to promote these trade.
Yeah. Okay. I think there are a lot of initiative, and to cover all this initiative, it will take a very long time. So I will very briefly mention some initiative which are really useful. And I will come to the first initiative as the authorized economic operator, or AEO it is called as, which was a scheme was re-changed and came into the July 16. I think this gives a lot of facilities to the trade to ensure that the higher risk management facilities are available, your material will not be inspected, you are able to take the direct port delivery, deferred duty is very one of the important feature of this authorized economic operator. You can get a 15 days credit, no bank guarantees or bank guarantees with lower values are possible. So this is one initiative. There are not many initiative on automation like eSanchit, which is there, so that the interface with people and the custom is reduced, that you can upload the document. The very interesting thing which I must mention here is a custom bonded warehouse, which the new regulation came into somewhere in October 19, which will allow you to do a manufacturing in custom bond or similar operation. So you can get imported capital good, raw material without paying duty. You do manufacturing, export it, absolutely no issue. Or you can bring it, you can defer the duty. If you are selling the domestic market, then you pay the duty and sell that. There are many features, many activities. I think we will cover when we, as we go in the course of the discussions.
Yes, sir, definitely. And sir, one last thing is that, you know, I think from the evolution, what we have seen, you know, from what customs was and from as on date, what customs is, how would you rate customs in terms of being friendly, and what more do you foresee from customs, or what is your wish list kind of thing to boost the trade?
Yeah, Hardik. One is that we know that people will never be satisfied with whatever steps taken. There will be always a wish list. But I can come, few things I can mention. See, the custom has changed not only in terms of processes, but with approach also there is a lot of changes. You can see that at every port there are meetings every 15 days. Or regular meeting happening called as PTFC or open house or a custom clearance facilitation committee, where you can go represent your things. Then there are bodies, and here the FFFI is also there. There are, the government is in listening mood, and I can mention one initiative. Last month there was on My Government Innovation, there was a CBSE has put a questionnaire that please give what notification you want to change, what process you want to change, very structured online approach. So these are a few initiatives. We should take advantage of this, definitely. The wish list is definitely much more, much longer, which is there in terms of requirement. But one important wish is that all the changes need to go to really the lowest person in the custom. So at ground reality should be also, if you talk to commissioner, additional commissioner or deputy commissioner, it should be the same. Every staff in custom should be doing the same thing. I mean, we need to percolate down this focus of top management of customs to the every person in custom, so that the, and as you go away from big ports to a smaller port or ICDs, I think we need to take this all changes to the grassroots level and to the smaller ports across the India, everywhere the same.
Right, sir. So I can summarize on a higher level. I can summarize that customs has now changed their approach from just being a guard safeguarding the Indian economy. From there, now they are more transparent. Now they are more approachable, and there have been the processes which are more visible and transparent, so that trade can participate rather than just going by, you know, what customs lays down. It's a interactive and a participative initiative which they have taken. And I think the second point what I will take it away is, you know, the customs should extend their reach with a higher speed, so that they can reach to the down level and we can see the innovations being implemented at the ground level as well.
Yeah.
Right, sir. Right. So then, coming up to the next point, sir, how you know, when we are mentioning that they have taken so many initiatives, so I think they are more towards the hassle-free customs clearances, and there are several steps which are taken by the authorities in terms of the ground reality. As you rightly said, you know, we are feeling we are getting a mixed review of its implementation on the ground reality. But do you think that, you know, customs, by doing all these activities, is actually losing their authority of the customs, is getting diluted, kind of thing? Like, you know, it's not only customs who decide, but the final authorities, the final release of the goods, the decision on final release of the goods have been spread across to other authorities as well. Because earlier, you know, any imports or exports, the customs were the final authority. So now, do you feel that we have that kind of different approach and authority of the customs is diluted?
I will
can add also.
Like, yeah, you know, okay.
It's open to all.
So I don't see, sorry Vijay, I will just make quick comment and then Vijay Kumar. Yeah. See, I don't think, I feel that the custom has got much more visibility than any time earlier. Looking at right. One place, they are have access to huge data. They have able to view the document sitting anywhere. I think they are able to do, I mean, custom has got the highest data which is coming to them online live. And they are in much better place to do some analysis, to do some work on that and visibility. So I don't see their power is reduced. On the contrary, I will say they have many new tools available in their hand to ensure the, to support the good trade and ensure that the people who are doing wrong to catch them fast and take the right action. I will say that. But Vijay Kumar, I think you can elaborate more on this.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Pramod sir, and thank you, Hardik and Saurabh, for this important webinar. Yes, your question, you are talking about the authority of customs.
Right, sir.
It's not reduced the authority of customs. Customs is the regulating authority of the all the cross-border transactions. There is no question of diluting the authority of customs. It is not, Mr. Pramod sir, already explained about the government is the customs is trusting more on that importers and exporters and the genuine business partners with government. So that doesn't mean that it is they trust more on that. It's a trust based. It's not a regulator now. It become a facilitator now. Customs,
right?
And you see that in this pandemic situation, the customs is the first to come. They digitize all the activity and the paperless and the faceless activity. If you see that, I'm not telling it is 100% successful. Everybody across the trade is happy on that. But I'll say that the thing, it is without any interference, any physical presence in the customs. The all this period, in the lockdown period also, all the essential commodities and general cargo also cleared. And customs is supported for the trade. And online you can do all these things, all the bonds, even all the undertakings or whatever the documentation is required, without presenting the originals and all these things, wherever they have to verify that the exemption certificates and all these things in that time. I just only talk about this pandemic period, how the customs supported the trade for that. When you are talking about the activities of customs, you know that now the most of the bill of entries or the shipping bill entries under RMS facilitation. Its system analyze all this document, and you have a facility to e-sanct all the document now, and system is processing your document for that. If you see the simplification procedure, if you see that, you can file all this online and automatic debit of your bonds, and your once you pay the duty or if you defer the payment of duty, the goods, the moment you register the goods, auto OOC, out of charge, and with a gate pass is generated. There the custodian, the data is transmitted to the custodian, and your truck driver can go and pick up the cargo for that. That is the facilitation given by the customs now for the status holder, not only status holder, even the RMS facilitated bill of entry, you can do that. In the same way, the export also. Now this extended the DPE, direct port entry containers. You file your shipping is for you send, take the container at your factory, stuff it, seal with an electronic seal, and upload the data into the custom system. Take the truck directly to the gateway port. I'm talking about the gateway port. If it is ICD, you can take it to there. And the gate, it is decoded, and the containers are allowed inside the terminal without. I'm not talking about, there are certain difficulties in that. It is not 100% as we expected it is happening, but it is happening in such a way. There are certain issues for that. Sometimes system will not work. If you see that sometimes the system is so slow, means you cannot do the process within that hours we expected. But it is, customs is going in the right direction for that. And the trade facilitation is really good from the custom side.
Right, sir. I do agree on that. Yes. And as we say, you know, all the new initiatives will have some teething issues. So I think these are all the teething issues which we are facing as of now. But I would like to know, sir, how is this, you know, how are these initiatives converting into benefits, tangible benefits to the trade in terms of, let's say, cost for say? So promoter,
you are not audible.
Okay. So I was thinking that whether you are asking me to me or Vijay Kumar, but yes, see, any benefit which is there, if it is not measured, you cannot explain that. Definitely, there are some benefits which has to be measured. So I will come back to the point which Mr. Vijay Kumar mentioned in COVID situation. You will not believe that we continue to clear the shipments right from actually. Initially, maybe delivery problem were there, material factories were closed, warehouses were closed, so you are not able to deliver the material, but the custom clearance was happening. RMS was working, material bill of entry was filed by CHA from a home or from office with limited staff. Custom clearance was going on actually. And there was so much support. First, it was only essential good, but then it was a normal cargo and we could clear the material. And every month we have seen the improvements. I was just mentioning before we started a seminar that July, we had a highest imports in last 15 years.
Wow.
And we are today back with a custom clearance time of already 1.5 day for close to 2000 consignment, which was cleared in August month. So we are already back to the normal as far as this concerned. So you are able to measure the benefits in terms of dwell time reduction, how fast you are clearing, how much demurrage you are able to reduce, how much is the documentation cost going down. So Let us say you are blocking the money with bank guarantees. If you are tier 2 or tier 3, then you are giving either only 25% BG or 100% BG off, then you save the money. So all the measures get converted finally into time and money. And this is very important, where our custom broker team also really helps to ensure that the working is done. See, we are talking about the deliveries taking also into second shift, sometime 24/7. So the people have to work on accordingly. So a lot much efforts is put, and we can see the results. We are able to measure such results. I am quite sure that if each company has got KPIs into place of clearance time. And another point which you can always see, the most of the ports now releases the dwell time report, which is very important. A time release study, which also shows overall improvement. So it is not that only the status holder are getting benefit, but overall there is a lot of improvement, and time release study shows that how the improvements are done. So I think they are measurable. You can quantify that, and you can be a part of that by implementing the good processes. I'm quite sure about that.
Right, sir. Thank you for this detailed answer, sir. So just one simple question which comes in my mind is, you know, as you rightly said that there are some time release study, there are individual dwell time studies which are being done. And I think at a broker level also, we are seeing these kind of reports which are coming across, so that the customs pushes the broker in terms of as the first point of interaction, so that it percolates down to the importers and the exporters. So, but from where this idea or from where this whole gambit of initiatives came across? Was it a Indian initiative per se directly, or was it WTO or a WCO initiative or a push?
Yeah, Harding, a really good question. I can mention one important thing. There are 2-3 factors which came into. One is that the World Bank is releasing the ease of doing or doing business result every year. Till few years back, it was never taken seriously, and we used to always say that we are different and we cannot compare all countries, 190 countries in same measure. But this has changed in last 5 years. You can see our PM's focus on the ease of doing business, which has also affected. And you can see not only India's ranking got improved in the ease of doing business from 143 to 63, but the trading across border, which is very important for international trade, has also come back from 146 to 68. So this is one part, that ease of doing business is a mantra. Second is WTO has come of what they call as a TFA, Trade Facilitation Agreement, which was enacted in February 17, when the 2/3 members are accepted this. And this, it is assumed that the TFA will reduce the trade costs by close to 14% to 15%. So TFA gives the guidelines to the customs across the world. What are the phases? What are the, and they have got 4 pillars. One is transparency, technology, procedures, and infrastructure. So you need to do improvements in 4 pillars. Then only you are able to reduce this cost. So TFA gives you very, very good broad guidelines where the each country can work from the when it got ratified to next 5 years to implement the various suggestions which are in annexure A, B, C. Some annexures can be implemented immediately, some will take time. So India has taken a really proactive step that they said that what are the suggestions in annexure A will be implemented immediately. Annexure B, we will implement in 5 years. And you can see that what we all talked about, AEO, e-sanchit, reducing processes time, out of charge, automatic out of charge, they fall all under TFA, so reducing timings and reducing the cost. So these are the 2 parameters. But apart from global push, unless otherwise you are local. So I think CBAC has done an excellent job of digitization. I think sometimes we speak to many private companies, they are not able to keep pace with the digitization which custom is going on and which has taken further speed in COVID.
Yeah. Right. In COVID, yes, definitely in COVID, we have taken a great speed in terms of digitization, being faceless and paperless and all. Thank you, Pramod sir. Vijay sir, would you like to add on this point?
Yes. The TFA, the first phase is almost all this thing is the way that faceless assessment is bringing. Yes, it is already introduced in Chennai, Bangalore, and on initial stage and extended to Delhi, and now in Gujarat also in phase manner. It is in before 31st. The public notice is already issued for that. It will be completed in before 31st of October.
Okay.
If you see that TFA, Trade Facilitation Agreement, India is moving in a very fast manner. If you see that almost all the activities in the first phase is almost all completed. And the trade is not ready to accept that speed. That's my, whether Pramod will accept or not, I'm not sure. That, but most of that thing in a very, very fast manner, they introduced all these things. That is the reason now if you see that time release study of cargo, that is very, very visible that what is that time. Time is money. So the cost and the time is reduced drastically. I mean, it's very, very, very visible in that, that the benefit extended to the trade, the benefit the trade got for this initiatives. See, I told you, know that the once the faceless also comes in place in full-fledged and hassle-free systems, I mean, without any disturbance. They, now, if you see that almost all the our RMS facilitation is about, depends on the port, it is 70% plus. And in air cargoes and all, in major air cargoes, if you see that on the same day, that majority of the cargo, more than 60% of the cargoes are cleared. So yeah, these are all benefits enjoyed by the trade on trade facilitation agreement and the digitization from the customs side. The another challenge with the trade now is the other partners in the Exim is not fully digitized for that. Even now, if you customs, you can do all these things. When you go a physical clearance in a CFS, still there are certain point. I'm not talking about all, but there are still the physical clearance. It needs some more accountability on that, because that the custodians and the carriers and all the supply chain partners has to be comes under one platform, and that again will reduce that transaction time and cost.
Right, sir. So a direct question which comes in my mind is that, you know, even Mr. Pramod sir said that, you know, we are not ready to cope it up, or we are not equipped to cope up with the speed at which the implementations are happening. So one of the partners, as you rightly mentioned, is the brokers who has to adapt the speed. And the other partner present in this forum is the custodian. So Saurabh sir, from your point of view, how are we coping up with these new initiatives, and what is stopping us, and what would we take to cope up with these initiatives?
Thanks, Hardik. I think great listening to Dr. Pramod and Vijayji. They have put forward very relevant industry challenges and where we are in terms of this subject. I want to start with two important points, Hardik. We discussed about cost and we discussed about digital initiatives. I think these are the two pillars around which we have discussed so far. On the first point, I want to mention that while we talk about cost reduction, and you had a direct question also for all of us as to what is the tax benefit we see, but cost is one part of the coin. And I want to put myself and all of us in the perspective of the end customers, you know, who are the exporters, and who are going to receive the shipments. Today, well, we are seeing a transformation in the industry where we are moving from a traditional regulatory umbrella or cost driven culture to another two or three very important emerging needs. First is real time visibility. And it's a very important thing. I think Pramod ji mentioned about the availability of data and how it's helping drive many new things. This is very important. Second thing is transparency in, you know, in every process and every step. And that gives gives result to, you know, greater confidence among the various stakeholders involved in the value chain. These two aspects are very important. And when we talk about digital initiatives in this framework, it is one new enabler that in the last decade, I have seen a lot of transformation which has been brought about by the customs authority. And I don't want to, forget the contributions done by each of the stakeholders. If you see in the last 5 to 7 years, where the trade, the freight forwarder and the CHS, they have upgraded their infrastructure to match up with the speed, to bring about address these emerging needs of our customers. If you look at cargo terminal operators and custodians, and you match them, all of them in the last 2 to 3 years have upgraded their base ERPs, have gone into air cargo community systems, have gone into an extended ERP, which is getting connected to the trade. Now, all this, what it is doing is that it is bringing all of us close to each other in a digital environment. Once we are all close to each other in a digital environment, there is a good visibility of what's happening, where is it happening, how is it being happening. Customs, and it is very, and I should say we are lucky that the initiatives which we are all driving is actually matching up, if not exceeding the initiatives taken by the regulator. See, at the end of the day, the customs are the gate, the controllers of the borders. Every goods comes and goes under their authority. So while they have developed an excellent system, and in 3 months, Vijayji and Pramodji mentioned about all the initiatives, including the latest faceless initiative, where the customs has said by in the next 2 to 3 months, all major ports will start using the faceless. But before that, they have automated, export processes related to LEO. They have automated the out of charge and made it very friendly. The unique thing about there is that they have designed a system which is not very rigid. It connects well via email format, via messaging format. It connects via various ERPs of custodian as well as with the systems which the freight forwarders are using it. So all these have been done. But answering your next question is that this is a journey. You can't say that customs have implemented these measures and trade is also picking up. Even if we all sit together and after 3 years, we will still be talking about areas where we need to improve because the customer expectations will go ahead. In fact, Mr. Pramod, representing the customer fraternity, the data requirement, the service level requirements, and the visibility will go up at least 2 to 3 times more. So it's a journey, and as I see that we have to keep working hand in hand, and a major part has to be done by also the freight forwarder and the agent community, which are maximum in numbers. Like you have one or two custodians every place. Maybe you will have hundreds of major exporter and importer, equal number of agents and freight forwarders are there in the market. So all of them have to move up in the same, direction for this to be really successful in the ground level. Adik.
Right, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Pramodji, you wanted to say?
Yeah, I just wanted, Hardik, if you allow me.
Yes, sir. Please.
This data transparency is very important. And as we see that over a period of time, our expectation from custom broker or freight forwarder has definitely gone really very high. And then they are able to match up to give the data in the required form, the copies into this thing. Like in Corona time, there was no, before that we have stopped getting hard copies from freight forwarder. We have stopped hard copies from CH also. And we could seamlessly connect on all the copies, do the checking, approval, timely payments. This all happened because there was a support and initiative from both sides. And we are also, just to be on this side, there was one step which Saurabh will also agree, we have earlier not connected with a community system with airport. I will not make names, but because this announcement will come in 1 or 2 days time, but we will have a direct feed from the airport custodian to our system in coming days. So I will have exact report of what time IGM was filed, what time the segregation happened, what time bill of entry is filed, what time the duty paid, what time the cargo came out, what is the truck number for cargo coming out, receipt, which will happen in next week. I think announcement will be officially be done. So it is important, and this community system, and Saurabh has touched really the important point. Only custom broker or only customs or only industry having their own good system will not work. Finally, we have to work to a community system, whether it is airport community system or report community system, where we need seamless data coming. I don't want to enter data 10 times. So this is what is a need. And custom being regulatory, but you can look at, there are so many ministries involved. If you look at number of ministries which are in logistics, shipping, civil aviation, railway, port, home affairs, Ministry of Commerce, Ministry of Finance, RBI, banks, then other ministries, wildlife, consumer affairs, animal, so many, which are already covered under SWIFT, many of them. However, to go to seamless, it will take time and it is a journey. I will fully agree with Saurabh that it is journey. Maybe we have this seminar next year. We will have something achieved, but still we will be talking still what is still required. So thanks, Saurabh, for your comment about this journey. I think this is going on, and Vijay Kumar will also agree, because most of us are in this area for last, I do not know, 25, 30 years, and we have seen this journey. It is journey which is going on.
Right. And I just want to add that, Mr. Pramodhan, sir,
if you see that the port community system, all the stakeholders, that Ministry of Shipping, IPA is the chairman of that Indian Port Association, they're working. I think you can see that in the before this year and itself, most of the people are on board on that port community system. Then, of course, it is like now that we have used tons of paper for printing the bill of entry and the shippable and all this thing. Now it is, everything is digital. It is reaching to the importers and exporters the same way. All the delivery orders, manifest and all SEMTR, the sea cargo manifest act is coming in place on October 1st. It will be implemented for that. Again, all this manifest, there will not be no papers in that. Everybody will be in this system. Then every activity will be time bound, and all the activities will be accounted. So then you can see that difference in that. But it's a process. I'm not telling everything will happen in the same time, but it is a continuous process.
And as we say, sir, I think the analogy, that is journey and the change. So basically the change, as we say, you know, the change is consistent. So in this journey, we will see that the change is consistent, and we will have to, the whole industry will have to adapt to these changes at all. So I think, sir, thank you very much for the participation from all three on this point of role of customs for ease of doing business. And the, I think what we have touched upon, what was my next question has already been touched upon, that is the utilization of the single window interface. So I think we have already touched upon that. So I'll go to the next point, that is, sir, we have seen, in spite of all these initiatives, the globalizations, the liberalizations, what we are seeing is there are few import policy restrictions which has been put across recently. So, sir, I would like you to throw some light on, you know, why this sudden change has come that Indian customs is bringing on all these restrictions, or I would not say a direct restriction, but there are some steps which has made the imports more difficult. So can you throw some light on this as well, sir, Pramod sir, Vijay sir?
Yeah, Hardik, it is definitely a difficult question, no doubt about it. Number one, that everywhere there are restrictions. It is not that everywhere it is a free. if you look at this quality standard, we are talking about in India, BIS. But we are also not thinking about that. If you go to Europe export, you are there is a EU marking. You go to US, there is a UL marking. You go to Middle East to sell something, then your product needs to have a printing in the local languages also. All the instructions should be there. So my belief is that these restrictions are everywhere, actually, number one. And India has done that in some areas. India find that it needs to be done in some critical areas, the goods which are important. Looking at the in country, you have many people who cannot identify the quality of products. This product should be certified by some authorized agency so that the common people who are buying these goods will not get cheated, number one. So such restrictions are coming, and probably they have increased their speed because everywhere the speed is increasing. If you are liberalizing something faster, then the changes which are so-called as a quality standards to be implemented, they will also get implemented faster. So people are finding that, yes, there are new restrictions are coming, which may be non-tariff barriers or which may be, which is become a faster. If you look at anti-dumping duties or a safeguarding duties, it is done in every country is doing, trying to do that. Our exports, what is happening in USA, what is happening in other place. So I don't say that we are doing something extreme. We are on the right track. We are balancing. But probably what happened is that anything news today become a news, and the people are looking at something which are more news, which will attract this thing. So such news gets. So I feel if you want to put any restrictions or any quality standards or non-tariff barrier, there is a process which takes a little long time. The industry is given a sufficient time to explain their stand, to go through the process. The proper hearings are done. So fact is that this will happen across the globe. It is happening. We are not exception to that. However, we need to be vigilant. See, in whole this thing, if you are agile, what is happening, then you are able to represent right way. You are able to give a right inputs, and you are prepared. I can say that. Definitely, if US is imposing so much duty in one night to people, I think India is that way having a good cautious approach to look into every aspect. We need to be agile. We need to represent right time. I think we should not be so much worried at the moment looking at the ease of doing speed, which is much higher than this.
Right, sir. Vijay, sir, would you like to add something? Hello, Vijay, sir.
Yes,
Would you like
to add something? It's already, Mr. Pramod. No, it's already explained by Pramod Sand in a right way. And of course, the Make in India, of course, I'm not going into the details of that, what restriction and all this thing. I don't want to comment on that. But of course, every country have their own, they have to keep their control on that. The quality of the products and every country have their policy to do that. I think all the questions answered by Pramod very clearly.
Right, sir.
I have no further comments on that.
So, sir, in this case, is there at a WTO, is there any reservations or is there any flags which has been raised on India saying that they have come up with certain restrictions or certain increase in the duties or something by any of the country, because India being a very big trade lane for all the countries. So between India, China, between India, US, India, Europe, I think we are having huge trade. So are there any reservations or flags which have been raised?
Hardik, WTO has got its own process of raising the dispute. You have a SCM agreements in which you can raise the, according to which you have to follow. If some country feels that India is doing not right, then it is raised in WTO. And then there is a mechanism by which you are able to represent your country to give the rights, what is, why this has been done, what is the rationale behind that. And then there is a learned people who are having more global view than us to look into this. So even though if it may be possible that many cases where charge been raised in WTO, but there is a sound mechanism on which you are able to represent that, and it takes its place. If you look at anti-dumping duty, you have a rigid, strong, very process. So India has got a highest number of cases where we have put the anti-dumping duty, but there is a proper mechanism which India is following, where the representation is given to the stakeholder in that country to represent, the Indian manufacturer represents there, and this is done. So there is a right process. So I don't think we should get worried about what WTO is thinking. If we are having the right approach and we are rational, it has been handled that way.
Right, sir. So in this case, sir, definitely there will be, like, you know, as we put some restrictions or we increase the duties for imports, there will be retaliation from the opposing country. So so is India geared to face these kind of retaliation as of now?
See, I think another difficult question from you, Hardik. But yes, if you look at, we have come long way. We have come long way in definitely developing many things which are there. We are biggest market. If you forget, only at the moment corona area time, but we are growing. Whole world is focusing on them, us. To ensure that, and it is not that only to sell in India, but the manufacturing in India. And I can say that, for example, Siemens is having 23 factories in India. We are the one of the top multinational who has invested into this country for manufacturing. And this has been done with a cautious mind and looking the so many years history. So that is, you can see the news which is coming. Irrespective of that, people are looking for India as a still a manufacturing base, new services and new opportunities. I am quite sure that even though Make in India is sometimes thought that, okay, is it only import restrictions? But it is always the other way around also. You are able to create a new jobs. I just give another example of this custom bonded warehouse. You look at that scheme. You can use that scheme for a global manufacturing. You can use that for global repair center or global this thing, which is a very good scheme. So always look at the... what any restrictions or any thought how they will create the opportunity.
Right, sir. Very well understood and very well answered, sir. So now moving on to the role of custodians in the overall industry. Basically, we are seeing that. Right. So we have seen there are some disposal of seized and uncleared cargo. There is a policy to it, and not all of them are aware about how the disposal happens, what is the policy and all. So Saurabh sir, will you please throw some light on this?
So Hardik, I'm happy and also surprised. This is a question generally doesn't come up in any of the, you know, conferences, but it's a good thing, you know. But I, you know, before I start, I just want to explain that custodians and cargo terminal operators are not warehouses. So we are just transit points, and this is a very important message that how we see our business. We don't see this as a place where goods needs to be stored, either import or export. You know, gone are the days when, you know, a big chunk of thought process used to be centered around the storage time and storage, you know, commercials. But we are in an age and we are aligned that is just transit points. The faster the good comes and goes out, the better it is for us and for the trade. With this background, I want to answer your question. What happens in many times? That the goods comes into the country for various reasons, either due to some misses or lack of preparation or some incidental reasons. If it takes, it gets stuck for a longer period of time. And that is what then comes under the disposal of goods for a custodian. So essentially, a custodian can dispose only those goods which if the bona fide importer you know fails to take the delivery act. Now if you have imported and if you don't come to claim your goods and it's lying for days and months in the warehouse, then something has to be done for those goods. So there is a clear policy, I should say a procedure of the customs. It is very nicely captured in circular 49/2018, which mentions line by line, giving timelines and responsibilities of the process to be followed to dispose of these goods in a very transparent and time-bound manner. Without getting into the details, broadly it says that if the actual importer doesn't come to claim his goods, we have to go to the importer, we have to go to the airline and tell them, yes, your good is here, maybe you would have forgotten, maybe there is some issues, please take it. Still, if he doesn't take it out, then, you know, under the directions of customs, these goods needs to be auctioned, because, you know, at the end of the day, it is, you know, it is under the government, you know, customs bond. And these goods are in a very clear, time-bound, transparent manner put into the, you know, the websites of MSTC periodically for a public to to value these goods, to see, evaluate, and take a call and get those goods by a bidding process. So there was some, you know, I should say, clarity required prior to 2018. But I can tell you with my experience in last 2 years working with the new circular, things are extremely streamlined. Customs is fully aligned, and I have personally spoken to many of the custodians at cargo terminal. This is no more an issue as it used to be. So that's broadly on that, Hardik. I'm happy to answer any specific aspects on that.
Right. So, sir, basically, when we say that the uncleared cargoes, I can understand about the seized cargo. But uncleared cargoes, let's say, for example, if I have brought in a shipment of, let's say, cosmetics, and I was not aware that there are some licenses to be obtained for cosmetics. So what happens? Like, you know, that cargo is uncleared because I don't have the license. Now, as an importer, if I am still interested to take that cargo, so what would be the process of, you know, auctioning it at your end? So is that auction happen without having the proper licenses by the person who is purchasing? Does that happen that way, or how does it happen?
So if a person is ineligible, to import or get a things cleared, he will remain ineligible. I think the point is that if an importer is ineligible to get goods cleared, he will still be ineligible. Once he is ineligible and the goods comes under the process of Section 48 of the Customs, which talks about the disposal of uncleared goods also, it then has to follow the set process wherein these goods will be listed in MSTC just like that. And there are bidders have to satisfy the eligibility criteria of the Customs and the MSTC. There is a clearly laid down eligibility criteria. Anybody who is eligible as per the criteria, he can bid for it and he can take. But point I want to say that if somebody is ineligible to import and he's barred from importing and clearing, I don't think that party can anyway get those goods. Auctioning is a separate process which assumes that the intended party is ineligible and cannot take the goods. It assumes that.
Okay. And it also assumes that the party who is actually buying it from the auction, so let's say a third party is buying it from the auction, is eligible to buy it and does have...
Yes, because before auctioning, Hardik, I think I missed out a point. Before anything goes into auctioning, it follows a proper laid down filter of approvals. Okay. There are not one. In fact, in those approvals, the PGAs are also involved. So once it clears those, only then it goes to MSTC. So that due diligence has been done. It's a very detailed thing. But the point is, it's not that custodian can simply go and auction a good. Okay. There's a set process and requisite approval involved. So that takes care of that question that you're asking.
Okay. So ideally, there are, if I'm not wrong, Vijay sir can correct me if I'm not wrong, there are some 48 different PGAs over and above the customs. So There are 48 PGAs, and as you are rightly saying that, you know, all these PGAs, whosoever is applicable for that product will come into picture even after the goods are, even when the goods are being disposed of.
Akshay, the only point is, Hardik, while the count of 48 is big, I think for all practical purposes, the only the relevant PGAs are touched upon. So, you know, it depends on the commodity. Not 48, maybe it'll be around 2 to 4 PGAs.
Two to three per se.
That's good enough. Yeah.
Right, sir. Right. And sir, we are coming towards the end of this session in terms of the last question, saying that we have seen we have recently had this Beirut port incident. I'm sure that it's a world famous incident by now, and there have been some unfortunate explosion on it. So, what are the basic learnings out of it, and you know what are the, like, who would be held responsible for this kind of incidents if it happens here in India or anywhere else in the world? So, is it only the custodian? Do you feel that the custodian is only responsible, or it is the importer as well as the custodian and any other government bodies you are seeing? So what are your takes on this, sir?
So I'll give you my take, and I would also request Pramodji and Vijayji, because I think with their experience in port, they can also pitch in. But from an air cargo perspective, Hardik, you know, you should understand that the air cargo is very, very tightly, you know, controlled, and there are very set procedures by ICAO annexures, and your also the Aircraft Act, and also you know IATA guidelines on what can aircraft. They're very strict, and it's not one, you know, bodies, international bodies, which actually defines what kind of goods can you know get into aircraft. And depending on the categorization and their data sheet, how we need to handle. B means it's the trade. How a freight forwarder need, how a custodian needs to handle a cargo terminal, and how I needs to handle. And this classification is maintained all through the life of the goods, as long as it is there in the chain. So, for example, you know, here we are. The example that you gave about explosive, that may not be very relevant. Because I tell you the kind of the material and the quantity, it doesn't come generally, or even if it comes, it doesn't, it's not handled, you know, by a normal trade. You know, it's there are specific bodies which handle it, and such shipment goes off in a matter of hours. In fact, you know, the highly explosive shipments. What I'll talk to you about is general DG shipments, which is a larger classification of the goods. And these shipments are very, 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 very closely monitored by all the stakeholders. And there are, even within our premises, there are exactly, you know, clearly marked locations. Those locations are under constant surveillance. And what is there, who has imported it, all those details are there. So as far as the air cargo trade is concerned, and the kind of example, that may not be very relevant. Having said so, even in case of a DG goods, which need not be explosive per se, it's a broad classification of chemicals and goods which has potentially dangerous characteristics. These goods are, if you ask me, in terms of being uncleared or lying, they are negligible across the air cargo industry. Even if there are goods, I want to tell you, and I want to highlight it with particular, that the authority, customs authorities, have a special focus on this category of goods along with us. So it's possible that the normal goods which are auctioning may take their own sweet time in the process in terms of compliance with PGAs and putting it to MSTC. But as far as the dangerous goods are concerned, these don't follow, that kind of a thing that do evaluation, ask
normal process,
auctioning. You don't auction a explosive generally.
Yeah.
So there are different approaches to handle this effectively, and to make sure that the first priority is that these DG goods should go to the respective authority. For example, I'll tell you, if there is an unattended RRY shipment, you know, you'll be surprised that we have to immediately inform the radioactive authorities, and they come into picture and they address it. So these are the various ways where these things are controlled. So I just leave it to Vijay and Pramodji to, you know, compliment on this.
Okay, thank you, Sarubh. I just want to, his question is the responsibility, and it's a collective responsibility. First of all, an importer is importing a dangerous goods or hazardous goods. The proper permissions he has to get first. What license is required, or any PGS permission is required, you have first place, you have to get that. And of course, once it is reached, the ports are handled in a proper, SOPs are there, and the law is very clear in India how to handle that. And the freight forwarders and the carriers are taking all the declaration which is required for to carry the goods. And once it is landed in the port, of course, the port is also taking care of, because you declare in the manifest itself what is the category of the goods. And the customs also giving that first priority for that to declare in that way. And yeah, by any reason, if that the compliance is not completed, then of course it is permitted to move to the proper storage place with proper escorts and all this thing. But you cannot compare this thing that Beirut, it's not, because proper things are in place in India as far as I'm concerned, because every people are responsible for importing these goods, and it's a collective responsibility. I don't think any once the cargo is moved to a CFS or any other ICDs, and they are responsible to dispose. It's not like that. In the first responsibility, I already explained that importer has to take that permission, proper permission, if it is a license is required for that, an explosive license or hazardous, whatever it is. So, very, very, I not come across any cases like Beirut or any other thing. I have not come across anything for in India for that. The proper law is in place and the procedures are followed in a proper way. That's my answer for this question.
Yeah, Hardik, I just wanted to add on that, because this is a topic which is very well covered by Saurabh and Vijay already. Yeah. I can say from industry side, there are so many courses. So generally, the people who are handling at airline, forwarders or CHA, they have their DG certified people already in the place who are well this thing. Industry need to also have similar people in their teams who are DG certified and those go regularly to the refreshing course. That number should be increased, then it is taken care at the origin itself, actually, so that the importer is starting initially. So he has got well certified DG people who are experts in this, who are trained and who are having a refresh course. So this number need to increase definitely, which will make the things much more safe. And as Vijay says, that it is a collective responsibility, but I think this will help for trade to make the further things safe.
Right, sir. So I think just to summarize this point, as you rightly said, sir, it starts with the importer and the exporter per se to do a proper packing, have a DG qualified person within their team. And after that, it comes to the handling of the cargo, wherein the other supply chain participants come into picture, as in the airlines, as well as the regulators like IMDG and the IATA comes into picture. And after that, I think we are coming to the landing point wherein the port comes into picture, that is the custodian comes into picture, and they have to handle it in a proper manner. They have a proper SOP in place, and you know, it's a faster clearances. The government, that is the customs, is also facilitating the auction or the movement, the faster movement of the uncleared cargoes and on. So collectively, it's everybody's responsibility to ensure that such incident doesn't happen. Right, sir. So I think we have covered all the points for today's topic, and it has been a pleasure. It has been a pleasure moderating the show, and I can see the knowledge bank. There's a huge knowledge bank within the three of us, and I think with this, India is in safe hands. So over to you, Basundhara.
Right. As As we reach the end of today's jam-packed session, I would like to extend my heartfelt gratitude to the speakers for such an invigorating experience. A special note of thanks to Mr. Hardik Thosani for moderating today's event to perfection. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
The indubitable importance of customs in bolstering the trade and business of a country lies unchallenged, and we take with us the suggestions and highlights from today on how to achieve a hassle-free customs clearance process in the days to come. As we acclimatize ourselves with the new normal, it is important that we take with us the learnings from the past, like lessons from the recent unfortunate port tragedy and the repercussions of the same, as we head towards making informed decisions ahead. We thank Gina and company for powering today's session and in making the event a grand success. Also, I would like to inform our viewers that the first session of our supply chain triathlon has been rescheduled to Wednesday, the 16th of September. So I look forward to seeing you all there. And last but definitely not the least, we would like to thank our viewers for their presence and their constant support in making today's event a success, and hope that you all found the event to be very enlightening. Thank you all and have a great day ahead.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Pramod sir. Thank you, Vijay sir. Thanks
to all of you.
Thank you.
Thanks, and look forward for more sessions, more intelligent sessions with you.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Bye.
Bye.